Welcome to I Advocate, a podcast series on the public policy process developed by the Emergency Medical Services for Children National Resource Center. In this video supplement to Lesson 3, you will hear from Tamar Harrow, Assistant Director in the Department of Federal Affairs at the American Academy of Pediatrics. She will share her opinions and advice on the importance of being an informed constituent and the most effective means of communicating with policymakers. Why is it important to be an informed constituent? That is, to know your cause and know your legislator's background and interests.
Well, I think it's important because these lawmakers are meeting with sometimes 10, 12, 15 groups a day, and so you're only going to likely have a few minutes with that policymaker. So it's important to be prepared going into it so that you're prepared to be concise and short and to the point, recognizing that these members don't have a lot of time. And also to establish that connection to show that you've done some homework prior to going into meeting with that lawmaker, I think it will make them a bit more receptive to the message that you're delivering to them.
How do you engage and maintain a policymaker's interest in your cause?
Well, I think it's always nice to start off a Hill visit, establishing that personal connection. Starting off when you do your introduction, identifying where you're from in that member's home state or district. Members are spending, oftentimes 4 or 5 days of the week in Washington, and oftentimes leaving family and friends back home. So it's always nice, I feel like, as an icebreaker to establish the connection of the home state. And then be personal. There's a lot of folks that meet with members who don't have a personal story to tell and are representing a particular interest. But as an advocate, if you can open up, for instance, if you're a parent or a grandparent and you know that that member is also a parent or grandparent, tell a personal story about how that child has been impacted by the healthcare system.
Post your visit with a legislator, what are things you can do to then maintain the legislator's interest in either the issue or the cause that you were discussing?
Always send a thank you, whether it's on email or written thank you. I think email is a quicker means of communicating with lawmakers and their staff. But send a thank you, and in that thank you, make it brief, but also highlight the key points that you met with them on. So if you're asking them to co-sponsor a bill, remind them of the bill name and number, and maybe a brief couple of words about what the bill does. And make sure you leave business cards in your meetings. You could even write a little bit about your expertise on the back of the business card. It's a nice, handy reminder for them when they find that business card sitting in the bottom of their desk a couple months later.
Do you have any other general tips or advice for influencing policymakers?
The key here is to establish a relationship with the staff of the policymaker. Staff on Capitol Hill play a key role with their members, and oftentimes it's far more important as an advocate to have that relationship with the staffer than it is with the member directly. So introduce yourself. Be friendly and available, be responsive. If the staffer has questions and needs follow-up information, make sure that you provide that in a timely way. These staff oftentimes are covering any number of other issues other than, for instance, healthcare. They might also be covering agriculture and transportation, and they're not gonna have the time and the bandwidth to be able to do the research on their own, and that's what advocates and outside experts, that's an important role they can play with the staff.
Can you tell us a little bit more about if you think it's better to hold a meeting with the legislator or his or her staff?
I honestly think the staff are key. It's always nice to have a photo op and to shake a hand with your elected representative. It's certainly a nice keepsake, and it's wonderful to have and to show folks back home. But the staff are really the ones that do that the members themselves rely on for policy expertise. For recommendations for how to vote on particular bills or amendments. They're also the source of ideas for legislation and for amendments. The members are busy. They sometimes serve on upwards of five committees and subcommittees. So the chances are you're most likely going to be meeting with the staff. And don't be discouraged. Like I said, I think it's important that you establish that relationship and share your information with the staff, and the staff report to the members about the meetings that they have. But these are the people that are providing the expert guidance for the members.
What should someone expect in terms of the legislative staff's experience?
Well, I think it varies. I think a lot of folks will be surprised to find out that the staff on Capitol Hill are awfully young, oftentimes in their early 20s, fresh out of college or graduate school, and that can be off-putting for a lot of people, but that is how Washington works. It is a very high-stress, high-demand place, and you are dealing with some of the best and brightest in the country in terms of staff. The Senate tends to be a little bit different from the House. I think the staff are maybe a little bit older than in the House, maybe have a little bit more experience. They're fewer senators, and that tends to attract more senior people.
Can you describe a typical day for a legislator?
So a typical day might involve, this is hypothetical, might involve starting off your morning with a 7:30 or 8 o'clock breakfast fundraiser or breakfast event. They might be giving a speech in the morning, and then they come into the office and might go right to a committee hearing. Oftentimes committees will meet in the mornings around 9:30 or 10, and then the afternoons at 2 and 2:30. So it's totally commonplace for a member to have multiple hearings in a day and to bounce between them. And they could be on incredibly varied topics. So you could have one on defense policy and then immediately go into one about higher education. In between those two committee hearings, they're meeting with constituents. They'll typically have a lunch either with their caucuses or their own lunches, and all the while meeting with constituents, and then and their evenings in either with evening events, speeches, fundraisers, and then of course there's the possibility of votes that take place all day long and sometimes are not scheduled. The Senate, they're very often not scheduled and very unpredictable. The House's schedule is a bit more predictable with the vote schedule. So their days are constantly being interrupted and pulled different ways.
Since you will often have very limited time to meet with your policymaker, what tips do you have for keeping your message brief and concise?
Well, I think it's a good idea to give some thought to the meeting before you go into it. And if you're in a group, maybe practice with your group about who's going to say what in the meeting, so that not everybody's trying to speak at the same time, or the opposite, nobody speaks. So it's important to sort of figure out who's going to say what in the meeting and which are the key points that each will raise within the context of the meeting. So beyond that, in the meeting itself, it's okay to have some notes. I think a lot of people, it's perfectly normal to be nervous going into these meetings, especially if you haven't done them before. Try to get to your point very quickly and concisely. So if you're there to talk about a particular issue and ultimately you're going to ask that the member co-sponsor a particular bill, try to get to that point as quickly as you can and leave time for the staff to ask questions if they have it. It's not always easy to gauge the knowledge base of the staffer on the particular issue. So sometimes it's good to ask, are you familiar with this bill? Because if they already know it, or for instance, if their boss is already a co-sponsor, you don't have to spend too much time discussing the issue, but be sure to thank them.
Tell us about a successful experience you had working with a policymaker. What worked and what didn't work?
Well, as a former staffer in the Senate for about 10 years, I found the most influential meetings to be the ones where people shared a compelling personal story that resulted in my being able to talk very specifically to my boss, who is a senator, about the importance of the issue for him to get involved in.
Can you talk a little bit about what to do if you are meeting with a legislator and he or she doesn't share your opinion, and I guess also what not to do?
So I wouldn't be dissuaded if your policymaker or the staff hold a different position than the one you're there to advocate for. You're there to share your viewpoints, and if they don't agree with your viewpoints, that's okay. You've expressed your views as a constituent, and always be respectful and say thank you and still do send thank yous and still do follow up, because you never know when an issue comes up down the road, there may be something that you find that you can agree on. Washington is a place where members of very different parties and different philosophical viewpoints oftentimes find issues to work on together, and that's how things get done in a bipartisan way. When members who like each other but disagree on most issues find an interesting issue to work on together, And same, I would say, is the case for advocates and for people meeting with their legislators. You don't have to agree on every issue, but it's important to establish that relationship. So in the event you can find something to be supportive with them on and work with them on, you take advantage of that opportunity.
What do you think is one of the most rewarding things about becoming involved in the public policy process from the standpoint of just an individual constituent? What can you gain from doing that besides just the one-time visit or the one-time letter of getting your message out there?
Well, I think it can be something as simple and small as establishing that relationship so that when you come the next year or you call on them in the future, that person knows who you are, and establishing that personal relationship. And it can be anything as big as that member writing an amendment or writing a piece of legislation or co-sponsoring a bill or voting a certain way because of the influence you had and the story you shared in your visit. The ultimate, I think, is to make yourself the content expert that they turn to, either the staff or the policymaker. I think back as a Hill staffer, some of the most, the best relationships I had either with my constituents back home who were experts in particular areas or people in Washington, you know, was for me to be able to call on them and seek their advice on what we should be doing or what they're hearing, because, you know, they're, you as the advocate and the expert are a bit of the boots on the ground, and you're closer to where things are happening, real life is happening, as opposed to being in inside the Beltway and in Washington. And so having that relationship that you've built such that that staffer, that policymaker is calling on you, inviting you to events back in the state or district or even in Washington, calling on you to testify before Congress, those types of things, those are all reasons why becoming involved in the public policy process is so important and can result in really great change.
What happens if you contact a policymaker's office to set up an appointment and they don't get back to you in a timely manner? What should you do?
That does happen from time to time. Offices are very busy, and it may, you know, I would not take it personally. Sometimes offices are just so slammed with meetings and the staff have back-to-back meetings or schedules are already booked. It is important to do your initial outreach to an office to set up a meeting as far in advance. I would say probably a couple weeks in advance to a month in advance. If they aren't responsive, I recommend at least trying to find somebody, if you're a member of a larger organization, who maybe has other contacts from your state or from your district, to try to find somebody who might know the staffer, know the member, and at least see if they might help you get through to the staff. And if you don't have that ability, I think it's still a good idea to drop by the office and at least leave your packet of information. We call them leave behinds, that have the main bullet points of the issues that you're there to advocate for. That's an excellent tool to have as an advocate, because the staff do meet with so many groups in a day, that it's a good reminder of what you were there for, and it's a good thing to have handy on your desk, especially if it contains any talking points, so that when the staff then goes to write memos and other materials for their senator or congressman or congresswoman, they can pull directly from your materials. So it's good to just drop by and leave those behind. You might ask at the front desk, you know, if the staffer who works on whatever issue you're there for is available. If they're not, you know, you just ask that person to make sure that your materials get to that person, and leave your card too, so that if they see them, they have questions, they know how to reach you.
Thank you for joining us for this video supplement to Lesson 3. Please join us next for the fourth lesson, in which you will learn how to apply these tips for communicating with legislators by viewing a series of mock visits with policymakers.